Hi folks, I'm Andrew. You're watching Prehistoric Australia. I'm very excited about today's episode because it's the final episode about Australia's inland seas that occurred during the Age of Dinosaurs. If you haven't done so already, go and check out our other episodes about the first four inland seas that flooded Central Australia and led to the rich diversity of marine life that prospered and hunted in Australian waters. But the big question remains, why doesn't Australia have an inland sea today? Well, in today's episode, part 5, we'll be answering that question. Along the way, we're going to learn about one of Australia's most devastating mass extinctions. So come on, let's explore the deep, dark depths of Australia's fifth and final inland sea. The final inland sea of Cretaceous Australia was formed 102 million years ago, and it represented the end of an era for many marine animals. The fifth sea is divided into three phases based on the dramatic geological changes that can be interpreted from the rock layers. In the history of life on this planet, global warming and sea level change often had dire consequences for life living in shallow seas. Late into the early Cretaceous period, global warming of ocean temperatures around the Earth's equator added too much energy to the Earth's oceans. This reduced circulation of the water currents diminished oxygen levels from being replenished near the seafloor. Marine rocks in the Tulabuk Formation tell us what happened to the Eremanga Sea 102 million years ago. The oxygen dissolved in the oceans was so low there was no bottom-dwelling animals living on the seafloor at that time. Without oxygen to breathe, they had perished. This depletion of oxygen in the water was a worldwide event known as the Oceanic Anoxic Event. The Oceanic Anoxic Event represented a minor extinction event. Bottom-dwelling animals were most impacted by the crisis, while animals living at the surface were less impacted, since they had access to normal levels of dissolved oxygen. The fossil record in the Tulabuk Formation supports this because it lacks fossils of bottom-dwelling animals, such as bivalves and crustaceans, but showcases many larger surface dwellers, such as bony fish, sharks, and rays. One of the larger plesiosaurs found in the sea was Eremangosaurus australis. The stomach contents and coprolites, or fossil poo, of plesiosaurs showed that they ate fish, squid, belemnites, crabs, and bivalves. We know it ate small prey because it had small, conical teeth. Marine deposits in the Alaru Formation of Queensland indicate that eventually the circulation of ocean currents returned to normal. Environmental conditions bounced back. The bottom-dwelling organisms of the Eremanga Sea were abundant once more in the fossil record, indicating that oxygen levels had risen. Biodiversity was great and life was doing really well. After millions of years of inland seas coming and going, it seemed the cycle would go on forever. But this phase would represent the final age of prosperity for life in the Eremanga Sea. This second phase of the fifth inland sea is represented in the rocks of the Alaru Mudstone. The Alaru Mudstone showed life thriving above and below the sea. Above the sea, flying pterosaurs soared over the waves, like Mythunga and Aussie Draco, searching for fish to eat just below the water's surface. Beneath the waves, animals such as bivalves, gastropods, crustaceans, ammonites, fish, crabs, and brittle stars would feed on plankton. In turn, these animals were fed upon by medium-sized predators in the ecosystem, such as squid and plesiosaurs. And these smaller predators were of course hunted by the apex predator, Kronosaurus. An ichthyosaur named Platyterygius was another apex predator of the Eremanga Sea. Ichthyosaurs were marine reptiles with streamlined, fish-like bodies. They also had enormous eyes, most likely to hunt for fish and squid in dark waters. With its last meals preserved in its gut, we know it was an opportunistic predator, preying on anything from turtles to even birds like Nanantius. Platypterygius australis was unfortunately destined to go extinct, probably due to a combination of dooming factors such as migration, food availability, and birthing grounds. If this apex predator only lived in the shallow seas of the Eremanga Sea, then the sea's final retreat would have spelled disaster for this animal. Sadly, by 90 million years ago, all of the ichthyosaurs in the world were gone. In only 2 million years, the sea had retreated to just south of Hughenden and Julia Creek in Queensland. The Alaru Formation showed that massive amounts of volcanic sediment from the eastern edge of Australia were being deposited into the sea. With all this sediment being dumped into the sea, the waters became increasingly shallow. This mud that formed this sediment would later become the mudstone that was the defining rock of the Alaru Mudstone Formation. Soon though, the Eremanga Sea would disappear forever. By 99 million years ago, the Eremanga Sea was on its last legs. The last areas of what would be considered inland sea were in fact clinging to the margins to the far north of Queensland. This area was very shallow. This new brackish environment was full of bivalves, gastropods, fish and other vertebrates, but it was lacking the marine life such as ammonites that had defined the marine deposits of the Eremanga Sea. Further south, the rivers had carried millions of tons of sand and gravel down from the volcanoes into the Great Australian Basin, until eventually there was more sediment than seawater. This infill of sediment, combined with a drop in sea levels, meant that the Eremanga Sea had vanished. In its place was a vast floodplain. The volcanic sediments that form these floodplains would one day become the sandstones and mudstones of the Macunda Formation. With the passing of the Macunda Formation, the Eremanga Sea was gone forever. The next formation in Queensland, the Winton Formation, dates to between 98 and 95 million years ago. At this time, the face of inland Queensland was changing. Dinosaurs such as Diamantinosaurus and Australovenator were free to spread out across the new floodplain environments, no longer hindered by a massive inland sea. The region was complete with conifer forests, rivers, billabongs, coal swamps, and extensive lakes. Volcanic activity on the eastern coast of Queensland continued until at least 95 million years ago. After volcanic activity came to an end, the Great Australian Basin experienced uplift and erosion from the Late Cretaceous period to the Early Paleogene period. The region became very flat, only occasionally punctuated by jump-up mesas. After 40 million years of geological evolution, the Eremanga Seas had finally transformed into the vast, flat floodplains we know as Outback Queensland today. Hi there folks, thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed our 5-part series on the Eremanga Sea. It's really fascinating just learning all about the Australian inland seas, which once inundated Central Australia. It probably wasn't as comprehensive as I would have liked it to be, but perhaps we'll cover a bit more about the Eremanga Sea in the future. Now, if you want to support us, feel free to support us on Patreon. Any donations whatsoever help keep this channel going. Feel free to like and subscribe to the channel and feel free to comment below. I would love to know what your favorite Eremanga Sea creature is. Otherwise, folks, thank you. We'll see you next time.